Have you ever been crippled by fear? Today's guest was so crippled by fear that she almost didn't step into the destiny that God had for her. Check out this clip of Elite Stanchek.
My life has been a complete miracle from start to end. My parents, when they first got married, the doctors told them that they couldn't have kids. And so my mom was just constantly praying for God to give her a child and to give her a baby. And she would actually go up and drive from Texas up to Rhema Bible School and attend the healing school there with Keith Moore. And she was just believing that God would give her a baby. And it took one word from Keith Moore one day, and it was a very sobering word from God. And he said, "You need to get out of yourself and start to serve others." And so she was like, "Okay, well, I can definitely do that." And she started volunteering with the 700 Club as a prayer partner and would go to the call center, and all these people would call her, but especially women that couldn't have kids. And so she found herself constantly speaking the word of God to these women, but didn't realize at the same time that those words were getting sown into her own heart. So it was a process, and a few years later, my dad ended up moving close to Chicago, and they were going to Steve Muncy's church in Indiana, and they're starting to go through the process of adoption. And on the way there, Pastor Steve went with them, and on the way there, he turned around in the car and pointed at them and said, "Do not settle for an Ishmael. God has an Isaac for you." And so they turned around, and a week later was when they conceived. And it ended up, the timing was crazy, it ended up being 7 years and 7 days exactly. And that was me. I was brought up in a Christian home, and even when my mom was pregnant with me, she had people prophesy over her that I would be abundant joy and full of glory. And she felt very protective over my ears and felt that I had a calling in music. So growing up, I walked with the Lord as a kid. I was saved in my kitchen at 5 years old and filled with the Holy Spirit that year, the year after that. And I just walked with God my entire life. And when I was 8 years old, I had a word from Dick Mills over my life that I would be a Christian music artist. Which confirmed a lot, because when I was little, I would sing all the time. Even when I was a little baby, my mom said I would never wake up in the middle of the night screaming or crying, but I would be singing. And that kind of continued on my entire childhood. I've always loved to worship God, and that's been a part of my makeup for my entire life. But my mom and my dad instilled a lot of the Word of God in me when I was little, and I had the opportunity to go to a lot of really amazing meetings and camps, and faith camps and things like that as a kid. And I've just always walked with God and always loved His presence. So even though I would sing myself to sleep sometimes, actually most nights, and would always be singing, but it was always privately. I would never sing in front of people. I would always get so nervous and so scared. And it really, when I went to go sing in front of people, it was like this demonic oppression of fear just settled on me, and I couldn't do anything. I was like paralyzed, and I felt like someone was grabbing my vocal cords and squeezing them. And it was obviously a demonic influence doing that. But this fear stopped me from singing in front of anybody, and I would only do it if I was sure that nobody was listening. So yeah, it was stopping me from my destiny that God had called me to be, that I knew that I was supposed to be a worshiper. I knew that I was supposed to lead people, but this fear was keeping me from what He called me to be.
Hello, we're back here with Elite Stanchek. I'm the host of today's show, Mark Wabuzewski, and we're gonna pick up where we left off. You talked about how you had this gift from God, even from a little child. Mm-hmm. You said your mom would hear you singing in your crib, and you just had this wonderful gift, yet you couldn't sing in public. The spirit of fear would come upon you. You'd literally feel as if something was choking you, mm-hmm. and your voice would quiver and shake. Yeah. But as I understand, now you're one of the lead worshipers at Victory Family Church, mm-hmm. which seats about 2,500.
Yeah.
So obviously you got over your fear.
Yeah.
Talk to us a little bit about how you were able to get over your fear.
So I had a great opportunity to go on a missions trip when I was 17 years old. I went with Sarah Bowling, and we went to Ethiopia. And it was a two-week-long trip, and while I was there, God gave me this amazing encounter and really showed me my destiny while I was overseas. So he lined everything up for this trip. Like, my family wasn't planning on going or anything. It was just me. I met up with a team of people that were older than me, and we went over.
What was it that made you want to go? Is it something you always wanted to do, or did you feel the Holy Spirit leading you?
Yeah, I really felt like I was supposed to be on this trip. I didn't know why. I had never been to that part of the world before. But I did feel like I really, really needed to go. And I'll tell you, God moved heaven and earth to get me to go on this trip. Like, I had summer classes that I had to take. I had all these vaccinations that had to be done in a short amount of time. And he lined up everything, and it went really smoothly. So I knew that this was supposed to be where I was supposed to be going. Yeah. So while I was over there, we were in the capital city, Addis Ababa, and then we traveled to Gondar, Ethiopia, which is up in the mountains. And while I was up in the mountains was where God really met me. We were staying at this orphanage, and at nighttime, like 10 or 11 o'clock at night, all of the workers that worked at the orphanage would come into the meeting hall, and we would be able to pray for them. And we saw people being healed from crazy things, and we saw some demonic things.
Were these people Christians or not Christians?
I'm assuming not. I don't think that they were. I didn't speak their language, so I wasn't 100% sure.
You had translators?
Yeah, we had translators, but obviously if there's a demonic possession happening, then they don't have the Holy Spirit living on the inside. So.
Right.
So we saw some things happen of that nature, which was the first time I'd ever seen that, like, right next to me.
Yeah.
It was a little scary.
What's happening?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't. Like, it doesn't matter.
Right.
But
yeah.
It was definitely, yeah, that was a life-changing experience in and of itself. So this is all going around. We were praying over these people and seeing God move. And in the midst of that, one of our translators came over to me, and he said, "Hey, I feel like I need to pray with you." So he started praying over me and was praying out, like, my destiny almost. And we were both praying in the spirit, and the power of God just came over me, and I was flat out on the floor. Don't know how I got there, but it was wonderful. I didn't want to get up. but I was on the floor, and God, he really spoke to me in that moment, because I knew that I was called into worship ministry, but I was wrestling with this fear thing keeping me from doing what I was supposed to do. And so while I was there, it was just me and God, and he spoke to me in that moment and gave me an ultimatum that was pretty crazy. He said, "You know, either you're not going to use the gift that I've given you, and, you know, I'll still bless you, I still love you, you're my daughter, but you're going to miss out on some things that I have in store for you.
Wow.
Or if you choose to step out and follow this path that I've destined for you to be on, I will do things in your life that you could never imagine." And so I'm wrestling with this because I'm scared to sing in front of people. I know I'm supposed to lead people in worship, but I'm terrified to sing in front of people. And this, it would, like, I couldn't even get a note out when I tried to sing in front of people. So I'm wrestling with this. And he said, "Well, if you let fear govern your choice here, I'm going to use someone who's not scared."
Wow. Yeah.
So
that scared you. You're like,
I was like, "Well, I don't want to miss out on what God has for me."
Right.
So I kind of was starting to move around and get up a little bit, and the translator came over to me and he said, "The Lord has a verse for you." Hmm. And it's Jeremiah 18:6, and he flipped open his Bible and he said, "Just like the clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, so don't be afraid."
That's crazy. And that's wonderful.
Yeah, oh, it was wonderful. And then to top it off, 2 days later, we're in a healing meeting, and this woman, she was a native, I'd never seen her before, but after the meeting was over, she came up to me and she said, "I'm a prophetess, and the Lord has a verse for you." And I'm thinking like, okay, I don't know you. But she said, it's Jeremiah 18:6. Don't be afraid. And he has you in the palm of his hand, just like the clay. And I was like, well, okay.
Like, oh, that's just a coincidence. Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to take that to heart, really.
No. But I was like, okay, I definitely need to do this. And even if I'm afraid, he's got me. So I came back, and like a week or two after I came back, I auditioned for our worship team.
You had like a fire now. You're like,
I'm like, well, I gotta do this now. Otherwise, he's gonna move on to somebody who's not scared to go. Right. So I went, and I'm getting ready for my audition. I'm like really nervous and everything, and I'm preparing my songs and everything. So I go in there, and I get up to sing, and like I'm nervous. Like I can feel that feeling starting to creep back up.
Like the same oppression.
Yeah, that same sort of like starting to tighten up and get nervous, and. And I did. I had a moment where I was like, okay, I'm being obedient, God. I'm being obedient here. Meet me where I'm at. And I sang the first note, and I was expecting for my voice to shake, and it came out clear as a bell. And that has been what it's been like for me ever since. Sometimes that fear will try to jump on me again, and it's like as soon as I literally walk up to my microphone and there's like a spot right in front of it, I feel it just lift off of me, and I'm able to do what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah, it makes me think all the people out there who think, I know I'm called to do this, but I don't know how I can do it. I have this problem. I have this weakness. Just ignore it. If God's called you to do it, then He'll make a way for you to get it done.
Yeah, and He will. And fear can't stop you. Amen. Like it will try. I'm sure you probably still feel it a little bit. But if you make a choice to be obedient to what God's called you to do, He is so faithful. He'll always meet you where you're at.
Okay, so you auditioned. I didn't get it.
No, I did. Yeah, no, it was awesome, and I was able to be a supporting vocal role to our worship pastor back in the youth ministry. So I was singing with all my friends, like the teenagers, and I was 17. And when I started going to college, I felt like I really needed to learn an instrument because that worship pastor ended up moving into our main service. So I felt like I needed to pick up the guitar, and I got one for Christmas, which is awesome.
So you moved into the lead then once he moved
out. Yeah, so he taught me how to play the guitar, and I've been leading from the guitar now, and so I have an ability to know the band stuff and the singer side of things.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And then being able to play the guitar kind of led you into another sphere of music.
Yeah, because when you have an instrument, then you can write music. So I started songwriting shortly after I played the guitar. And some of my friends would come over when I moved up to Cranberry, and we would get together and have these worship nights at my house. And out of one of those worship nights, this song called Tried and True came out of one of those moments. So me and a couple of my friends were singing, and we had the chorus down, and we were just worshiping on that for a while. And then the whole room just got dead silent, and it was like everything just went quiet. And out of nowhere, this melody came out of me with words, and the whole first verse just like came out of my mouth, and then there it was. And we were like, oh my gosh, we have to write this down like right now. And we wrote it down and we recorded it. And that was the missing puzzle piece to the song. And I've never had that happen before. It was like...
So you were surprised with everybody else.
Yeah, like, we were all like...
Wait, where'd that come from?
Yeah, we were all like, whoa, oh my gosh. And it was such a beautiful moment. And we were able to finish the song that night.
Yeah.
So that was a really cool songwriting experience.
And that was the first song you ever wrote?
Yeah, the first song that I ever... like really felt like, okay, this is a worship song, you know? And about 3 years later, the song just kind of sat there for about 3 years. And for Easter, our church was looking to do something original and something kind of different and special. So I was like, oh my gosh, Tried and True is talking about Jesus' sacrifice. It's perfect for Easter. So I ended up playing it during a meeting, and that same presence that filled the room, it happened in that moment in our meeting. And everybody got so excited, we decided to do a music video, and we played it for our church, and we've done it a few times since in our worship sets, and it has been so fruitful and wonderful, and it's just really cool how God used that song, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And since then, you've gone on to write other songs, and you have what really feel is kind of a calling to write and produce music. And wasn't there a prophecy to
something? There was. Yeah. When I was 8 years old, Dick Mills, who's a wonderful prophet, he prophesied over me at our church. And he said, you are called to be a contemporary Christian artist. And I was 8. So that word has stuck with me. And writing music goes along with that.
Yeah.
And so it's cool to see that part of my calling come into play like now.
Yeah.
This is cool.
And then Tried and True ended up kind of being a bridge to another song that you ended up writing.
Yeah.
Can you tell us how that happened?
So Tried and True was that first one. And then I went to school at Bethel's Worship U experience out in California this past summer.
They know a thing or two about worship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're pretty great.
Yeah.
It changed my life. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
But when I was there, they gave this amazing little nugget saying that if you write music, you should really write prophecies that, like, take prophecies that have been spoken over your city or your church or your region and put those to song. And so I was motivated when I came back. I called, like, all kinds of churches looking for prophetic words and trying to collect these words so I could write songs incorporating that and then singing that over our city and over our nation. So I met this wonderful woman, Sue, and her husband run a prayer group over Pittsburgh, and she had exactly what I was looking for. She had a pamphlet full of prophetic words over Pittsburgh, and so she gave that to me, and one night I was just at home, like, hanging out, and I just had this feeling that there was something, like, inside of me that needed to come out. So
yeah.
I went up to my room, and I grabbed my guitar, and I grabbed that pamphlet, and was reading through one of these prophecies, and one of them said that Pennsylvania is the keystone state and that we're going to be the key to unlocking our nation in a revival.
Go Pennsylvania.
So I'm like, wow, okay, well, that needs to be written into a song. And so the same thing happened that happened with Tried and True, but I didn't co-write this one. It was just me and God.
Yeah.
And I wrote the song in like an hour.
Wow.
And there it was, and the next day I was able to play it for our creative team, and we're just praying that this song and many others like it will just become an anthem over our city.
Wow. And what's this called again?
Oh, it's called We Are the Key.
We're the Key. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that other songwriters will start to do this, and we'll sing in a revival over our region.
Huh.
Yeah.
So, like, worship's going to be kind of a catalyst to revival.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, that was confirmed at a Bethel concert a couple of weeks ago.
Wow.
And one of the worship leaders, Stephanie Gretzinger, she had a word over Pittsburgh and said, there's going to be a revival in music that happens over your city. And I was like, oh my goodness, this is amazing. And then right after that, William Matthews, who's also a worship leader with them, started singing May the Songbirds Sing. Let the songbirds sing.
And songbird, I know that means something to you personally and to your mom.
Yeah.
Right?
So ever since I was a baby, my mom would call me songbird because I'd always be singing.
Yeah.
And so when he said, let the songbirds sing,
that's amazing.
I'm like,
yeah.
Okay.
Most babies cry, you would sing.
Yeah.
That's kind of a good deal for your parents.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's
yeah.
great. So that prophecy happened.
Yeah, that was really
And it really makes sense. The Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people.
Yeah.
So like the presence of God literally comes when we're worshiping him.
Yes.
And as you know, when the presence falls, it testifies to his power, to his love, to the glory of God. And it really makes you want to serve him. It makes you want to know him more.
Yes.
So it's no surprise that that can be used as a way to usher in revival and to get people to really get on fire for God and
Absolutely.
Just have it spread, have the fire spread all over
Absolutely.
Through worship. So I think that's amazing.
Yeah, he shows up when we worship, that's
Amen.
For sure.
Yeah, I know now how powerful worship is. Growing up, I didn't like it. I would never sing, you know, but... And when I got spirit filled, I realized there really is a presence that comes when you worship. So even though I'm a terrible singer, it's worth doing just for the presence of God.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And And I know Tried and True, you were at a conference and someone asked you to sing that. Or tell me a little more about what happened there.
So even from when I was little, when I was worshiping in my room, there were times where I would see angels in my room as I was worshiping. And I remember very vividly, I must have been like 4 or 5 years old, and I would sing myself to sleep like every single night. And I just looked over in the corner, I had this big rocking chair, and there was an angel sitting in the rocking chair. And I ran and told my mom, I was like, oh my gosh, there's an angel in my room. She's like, well, that's awesome, just keep singing.
Yeah, so. Most parents would be like, oh, good. Yeah, talk to him. But your mom actually believed you.
She did, yeah. And then when I was at this women's conference last fall, we ended up singing Tried and True. It wasn't planned, but one of the leaders said, I know you've written a song, will you sing it for us? And I was like, okay. So I grabbed my guitar and went up there and did Tried and True. And I'd never sang the song like I sang that afternoon. Yeah. And it was like people were latching on to the lyrics and were understanding what the song was saying. And this presence just filled this conference room. And when I was done, I walked off and I was like, wow, that was awesome. Wow. And this woman came up to me and she's running up to me. She's like, oh my gosh, did you see the angel that was behind you? And I was like, no, I don't know. I didn't see anything.
Right.
And she's like, yeah, there was a giant angel behind you. And I saw him turn and there was a scroll on his back. And she said, the Holy Spirit told her that scroll that the angel was carrying contains all of the songs that I'm supposed to write.
Wow.
And that he's not going to leave me alone until I write them. Huh. So
he's a big angel. You want to do what he wants.
It was a big scroll. He had to carry it. I believe, what you said, that God's presence, it habits our praise.
And when you were singing, you said the presence came. So like there was an anointing on your voice as you're singing that literally ushered in the presence of God.
Yeah.
And then the angel was there.
Yeah. And that's my heart. I want to see people healed and set free in worship, and to have angels be present while we're singing, and for heaven to just, you know, happen here on earth as we're worshiping God. And so I fully expect for God to continue to do that over with tons of churches over our nation. I want to see that happen.
Yeah, you got tapped into your destiny, what God created you to do. You're doing it.
Yeah.
And you know what it is to have abundance.
Yeah.
You know, Jesus promised the abundant life. You know, the Bible in John 10:10, it says, the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. Yeah. Jesus said, but I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
So many people don't recognize that there's abundant life in following God, and everything else is just a counterfeit. You know, all the abundant, this world thinks abundance is money and things, and all that stuff can be good and it can be used for good, but that's not abundance. Abundance is having true peace with God. It's about tapping into your true purpose. Yes. And it's also about giving to others. I mean, we're blessed to be a blessing, to give back to others, you know, and it starts with getting right with God and doing what he wants you to do, because he knows what's best for you.
So true.
You know, and there's so many people out there who are deceived by the devil. They don't understand that the best place to be is in God, to be his. And I want to encourage all of you out there, if there's anyone out there who knows that they're not right with God, or maybe they were and they slipped away, the first step to true peace and true life and an abundant life is to get right with God. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer right now, and I ask you to say this after me. Say, Dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and that you rose from the dead. I trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. I give you my life, and I ask you to give me strength and wisdom on how I should live my life. I thank you and I love you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And it's not something that you just do once. It's not like, oh, I did that. It's you give him your life. You don't take it back. You seek God and then you find him. Mm-hmm. And he'll put you on this path. And you'll find true peace, true abundance. We can't even explain how wonderful it is to serve God. You need to experience it for yourself. And if that's you, if you made that decision today, or you want to reach to us in any way, please give us a call at 1-855-981-9777 or 724-981-7777. And we'd love to hear from you. And we want to help you connect to a church, or we're here to serve you in any way that we can. So give us a call. And right now, we're actually going to go to a song, the one that you wrote, the first one that just got downloaded out of you, called Tried and True. We're gonna play a small portion of that song here as we leave so that people can see you in action singing. So check out this song and enjoy it. We love you and God loves you.
Sign, precious one. died for me. Jesus Christ, raised to life, my God, you set me free. Firm foundation. So